Good morning. Welcome back to the course of Power Quality brought to you by VTU eShikshana. I am Dr. Prema from BMS College of Engineering, Bangalore. So today we are going to see the sixth lecture of Module 3. I am teaching the course Electrical Power Quality with the course code 18EEA25, and we are dealing with the module 3 now. I'm taking the sixth lecture. In the last lecture, we have seen some of the harmonic sources produced by industrial loads and custom commercial loads, such as the power supplies, both single phase and three phase. And then we saw adjustable speed drives. Then we saw many other loads which are commonly used in industrial and commercial applications, which can cause harmonics in the power system. And we also saw not only this commercial load, such as nonlinear loads, the system components also can cause harmonics in under some certain circumstances. And there are three main important system parameters which gets affected or which can also cause harmonics under some conditions. They are the short circuit impedance, and then the capacitor, shunt capacitance, which are connected to the power system, and also the resistance in the system. So these three can also cause harmonics under certain conditions. This was a recap of lecture 5. And today in lecture 6, we are going to continue this, and we are going to see how these system parameters, resistance, shunt capacitance, and the short circuit impedance can cause harmonics under some conditions. And we are going to see what are those conditions under which this can cause harmonics. And today we will also see the effect of harmonics on various other loads, such as transformers, motors, etc. So this is for today. Let us start the session. So today, first we are going to see the condition of parallel resonance. So you would have studied earlier in your lower semesters about the series and parallel resonance. And we know that the resonance is a condition of the circuits which has both resistance, inductance, and capacitance. When all these three are present, and when they are connected either in series or in parallel, then there can be some certain frequencies at which the phenomena of resonance can happen. And under these phenomena, if it's a series resonance, the impedance of the circuit will be equal to the resistance of the circuit. And when the inductive reactance and capacitive reactance get cancelled each other, the total impedance of the circuit becomes completely resistive. And under such cases, the current can increase highly. Similarly, we have parallel resonance condition also. So under these conditions, let us see what happens in the system. When a system has normal sinusoidal voltage, this resonant frequency does not cause any problem in the system, because there is no way the resonant frequency comes into picture. But when we have harmonics in the system, the case is different. So what happens when we have harmonics? We all know that all the inductances and capacitance can have more than one natural frequency, which can cause resonance. Now, when that resonant frequency becomes equal to one of these harmonic frequencies, so we know that in harmonics, we have several frequency components which are present. Say it is an integer multiple of fundamental frequency. So if your frequency fundamental voltage is 50 hertz, we can have harmonics of third, fifth, seventh, etc., any of those frequencies. So those frequencies are present in the system. And when the resonant frequency matches with any of these harmonic frequencies, then the condition of either parallel resonance or series resonance can occur in the system. Now, let us see what are the actual effects of this resonance in the system. Now, in the figure shown here, this is a power system. And you can also see that there is a capacitance connected in the shunt. This is the shunt capacitance. And generally, we connect these shunt capacitances for power factor improvement in the system. Now, this particular diagram is a distribution system where there is a potential problem of parallel presence. So when the shunt capacitance appears in parallel with the equivalent system inductance, the equivalent system inductance may contain the source and the transformer inductances. So we have a source and transformer inductances in the system, and when this capacitance comes in parallel with the inductance, then we can have a condition of parallel resonance. Now I'm going to show you the equivalent diagram of this particular condition where we have the shunt. So in the first figure, figure A, we have the simplified distribution circuit where I have shown only the capacitance, shunt capacitance, and then we have IH. The IH is the harmonic sources, so current produced by the harmonic sources. This can be any nonlinear source present in the system. So you have IH, and then we have the shunt capacitance. We also have the impedances of the source and the transformer. So here X source in the figure A, X source indicates the impedance of the or the reactance of the source, and XR is the reactance of the transformer. So these two are in series and which is in parallel with the capacitance. And we also have a harmonic current from the nonlinear harmonic source. And figure B shows the equivalent diagram of that. In that equivalent diagram, what we can see, we have the harmonic current source, IH, and then we have the capacitance, which are the shunt capacitance in the power system. And also we have the inductance or the inductive reactance of the source and the transformers, which are coming. So you can, it is very clear from the figure B is that this is having a condition of parallel resonance. Now, what exactly will happen during parallel resonance? This parallel resonance occurs when the reactance XC and the inductive reactance from the equivalent inductances of the source and the transformer, when they become equal, when they cancel each other, the process or the phenomena of parallel resonance occurs. So at that time, the resonance frequency is going to be 1 by 2 pi square root of 1 by L equivalency minus R square by 4 L equivalent, where R is the resistance of the combined equivalent source and capacitance. So we have a resistance also, which was not shown in the previous diagram. With the presence of inductive reactance, we will have a resistance also in coming in the system. So we have the R is the equivalent resistance of the combined source and the transformer, and L equivalent is the inductance of the equivalent source and the transformer, and C is the capacitance of the capacitor bank, which is connected for power factor improvement, shunt capacitance. Now, so you can see that this term R square is when we are comparing L and C, generally it will be in millihenry and microfarad. So 1 by LQ, L equivalent C will be much higher than R square by 4 L equivalent. So approximately we can write the resonant frequency as 1 by 2 pi root of 1 by L equivalent into C. And the impedance of the circuit under resonance will be X square of L equivalent upon R or XC square by R. This can also be represented with the term Q, where Q is the quality factor of that particular coil or the combination. And Q is defined as XL by R or omega L by R, and or it is XC by R, where R will be very much less than the X equivalent. So the Q is the quality factor in the circuit. So what happens at resonant frequency? The apparent inductance of the parallel combination of the equivalent inductance and the capacitance as seen from the harmonic current source will become very large. So the apparent inductance will become very large. Because of that, there will be a voltage distortion, high voltage distortion, and due to that, there will be a current distortion also. And Q, as I told, Q is the quality factor of a resonant circuit, which will generally, it's the quality of the coil, we'll say generally, and that determines the sharpness of the frequency response in the system. And during the condition of parallel resonance, there will be a small harmonic current, which will cause a very large voltage distortion. So that is the main effect of harmonic current, where the voltage distortion becomes very large. And how the Q is influencing the harmonics is because the value of Q varies considerably by the location of the power system. So when the location of the power system changes, the value of Q also changes. So the Q may be less than 5 for a distribution feeder and more than 30 for on the secondary bus of a large step-down transformer. So Q can vary considerably with the position of the power system or where exactly we are measuring the this particular phenomena. And the voltage at the time of parallel resonance is a product of Q, XL equivalent, and the harmonic current. Where when Q changes, your voltage distortion also changes. So as Q is higher, the voltage distortion also will become higher. And so this can cause failure of the capacitance. It can blow the fuses, or it can overheat the transformer. So all these are the effects of parallel resonance. Now, this parallel resonance can be affected by the size of the capacitance also in the system. So as your shunt capacitance varies, the harmonic current and the harmonics at which the parallel resonance happens also will vary. Now this figure shows the variation of the inductances for various values of the capacitance. We can see that the extent of voltage and current magnification at the time of resonance can be determined by the size of the capacitance. So if the shunt capacitance bank size varies, the magnitude and the frequency at which the resonant frequency happens also can vary. So you can see that without a capacitor, it's almost a straight line. This curve we have seen yesterday, the harmonic number versus the impedance in the at the time of harmonics. Now you can see that at 10% change in the capacitance, the curve is different. So for various values of the capacity of the shunt capacitor, the curve changes. So impedance, the effective impedance changes with the capacitor. Now, when we are measuring the harmonic number, HR is the harmonic number at resonance. So resonant harmonic number, we say HR. When we are calculating the resonant harmonic number, why do we have to see that? We have to see the or the calculate the resonant harmonic number so that later we can design a filter to avoid the condition of resonance. So when we are calculating that, it is generally the it is the square root of capacitive reactance to the short circuit impedance in the circuit. Now, when generally in power system analysis, typically we don't have the values of L and C readily available with us. So, but we have the NVR rating and NVR rating available. So we can calculate the resonant harmonic resonant number also from as the ratio of square root of ratio of NVA, short circuited NVA upon the capacitor NVAR. So that is also a kind of method by which we can calculate the harmonic resonance number. So this is the case of parallel resonance. So parallel resonance happens when we have a shunt capacitance and when we have the inductances and of the inductance of the source and the transformer which come in parallel with each other. A similar case can occur in when they come in series also. So at some conditions or some situations, the shunt capacitance and the transformer inductances of the distribution line. So we have distribution transformers in the distribution line. So at some cases, the inductances of this distribution transformer line or the inductances which can come in series with the shunt capacitance also. So in such cases, we will have the phenomena of series resonance instead of parallel resonance. So such conditions also can occur. Now, what happens? When the resonance frequency of that particular circuit, when they come in series, is equal to any of the harmonic voltages or any of the frequency of the harmonic component present in the system, then we have a condition of series resonance. So, in case if the customer does not have a nonlinear load also, but if they utilize the power factor improvement capacitors, most of the industrial plants, they have a power factor capacitor bank to improve the power factor. So even if they don't have a linear load, and if they have a capacitor bank, then they can experience a very high harmonic distortion. That may be because of the neighboring harmonic source. Or if the there is a neighboring plant where they use a nonlinear load, that also can affect this particular industry where they don't have a nonlinear load at all. So after this, in the next lecture, we are going to see some case studies where we will see all these cases in a practical situation. So now I'm going to show the circuit where there is a potential possibility of series inductance. And here in this figure, we have a similar case where we have a shunt capacitance, but we also have a distribution transformer which is coming in series with the capacitance. So we can see that we have a capacitance, shunt capacitance, which are in series with the transformer, and there are many nonlinear loads shown. See, all these arrows shown are the nonlinear loads in the system which are producing harmonics. So we have harmonics in the system. We have also a series combination of inductances and capacitance in the system. Now, if you draw the equivalent diagram of this, it will be like this. We have the source, we have the impedance of the source, also we have the impedance of the transformer, and it is coming in series with the shunt capacitance. So we can see that the nonlinear load can produce a harmonic, and IH represents the equivalent harmonic current taken from the contribution of all the nonlinear loads present in the system. So we can see that the nonlinear load is in series with the harmonic current is in series with the inductances in the circuit and the capacitance, which is a shunt capacitance. So this can cause a series resonance. And we know that under series resonance, the inductive reactions and capacitive reactions cancel each other, and only the resistance will be there in the system. So the impedance of the system reduces significantly because of that there will be an overshoot of current which is happening in the system. So that happens here, and then the current goes to a very high value, which can produce voltage distortions in the system also. So we have mainly the harmonic current is produced due to resonance, and that will have the voltage distortion also. So we will see how we can calculate the series resonant voltage, which is the ratio of Xc by the total impedance plus the resistance of the circuit, which can be approximately the ratio of Xc by R into Vx. So we can see that the varied value of the shunt capacitance value also can vary the voltage in the system. Now, the real problem is when there are some cases where you will have both series resonance and parallel resonance coming in picture. Under these conditions, the situation becomes very worse, because you will have both these conditions at different values of frequencies, and then the distortion also gets higher and higher. So when both series and parallel resonance happens, the parallel resonance frequency will always be lesser than the series resonance frequency. Now, with all these conditions prevailing, we have series in resonance conditions, we have parallel resonance, sometimes we may have both series and parallel resonance. There is a very simple method to reduce the effect of this harmonic by adding an extra resistance across the capacitance. So if you have an extra resistance in the capacitance, that can damp or that can reduce the resonance curve, that can damp the resonance curve or that can reduce the impedance in the the total impedance of the system if you have a resistance. And that effect is very significant. And that curve is shown here in the figure. Here, the damping, you can see that the inductance goes to its maximum at the zero resistive load. Now, if you are adding a small resistance in the capacitance, if you are adding 10% resistance is added across the capacitance, see how the resonant curve is dampened and how the inductance has reduced. So there will be a significant reduction in the inductance by adding a very small value of resistance in parallel with the shunt capacitance. So this is one very simple way which can eliminate the problem. It may not eliminate, but it may reduce the effect of harmonics in the case of either series or a parallel resonance in the system. So this is one of the remedies which can reduce the harmonics. So these are the situations which can cause harmonics. So we have seen the sources from the commercial and industrial. Nowadays, residential loads also cause harmonics, because in all the residential loads, we have all type of nonlinear loads in it. So wherever we have nonlinear loads in the system, we have harmonics present in the system. So we saw what are the main sources. We also saw how the system parameters, the power system parameters, can also cause harmonics or voltage distortion in the system. Now we are going to see what are the main effects of harmonic distortion. Of course, in the first lecture, we have seen a glimpse of the effects of harmonic distortion. Now we are going to see little detail with some waveforms and all. So how are these, we know that harmonics are produced because of the nonlinear loads, and we also know, we have also seen that these currents, we interact with a wide range of power system equipment also, and mostly they interact with the capacitors, they interact with transformers, motors, and they cause additional losses in the system, and they cause overheating, they have caused overloading of the equipment such as transformers, etc. All these are the problems of harmonics. Now we are going to see how are they going to affect particular equipment in the system. So let us take first the case of capacitors. Let us see what are the impact of capacitors because of the harmonic distortion. So we know that just now we have seen that the capacitor banks will experience very high voltage distortion in the case of resonant, whether it is a series resonant or parallel resonant condition. Now, because of that, the volt current flowing through the capacitor bank will be significantly large, and due to which there can be failure of the capacitance also. So in the figure, it is shown the current, the capacitor current in a system when there's a 11th harmonic. So here, the 11th harmonic component of the current is matching with the resonant value of the system, maybe with the shunt capacitance, and we have a resonance at 11th harmonic frequency. So we can see that at some at such a situation, at the 11th harmonic frequency, the RMS current will be much higher than the capacitor RMS rating. So when the capacitor current rating or when the actual capacitor current goes beyond the rating, the capacitor blows up. So there are some standards which are provided by IEEE on which we have to design the transformers when we're designing the shunt capacitance in the power system. So the KVR rating has to be 135% of the nameplate. So the nameplate will have a KVR, but the actual capacitor rating should be 135% or 35% more than the KVR rating. So that is for the safer side, that is to accommodate the RMS current due to the harmonics. Also, the RMS voltage has to be 110% of the rated RMS voltage. So that is to include the harmonics. That is not for transients. We are talking only of the harmonics here. And the RMS current, RMS voltage has to be 110%, and the RMS current has to be 180% of the rated RMS current, because current can go really peak during the resonance. Also, the peak voltage has to be 120% of what is given as a rating. So generally, when we have shunt capacitances, there will be some value in the nameplate, and it will be always overrated. Like the capacitance value will be, the KVR will be 135%, and the voltage, peak voltage will be 120%, etc. That is to accommodate the harmonic currents in the, not that every time when you have harmonics, the capacitor should not blow up, right? So because of that, we have to take these precautions. Now let us see what are the impacts of harmonic on the transformers in the system. So generally the transformers are designed to deliver the required power with minimal losses under one fundamental frequency. So the transformers are designed for that. But we have harmonic distortions, we have voltage distortion, and we have current distortion, which can significantly contribute to additional heating in the transformer. So we have seen that earlier also. I have shown you one thermal image of a transformer where the heating is increased because of the harmonics. So when we are designing the transformer, we have to accommodate for higher frequencies also. So the designers have various methods to accommodate that. They may use transpose the cable instead of the solid conductors in the transformers, and they will add more cooling ducts to dissipate the heat produced during the harmonic currents. So as a general rule, a transformer in which the current distortion exceeds 5% is a derate, is a candidate for derating of harmonics. Now there are mainly three effects that result in increased harmonic heating. One is RMS current, then we have eddy current loss, and the core losses. So these are the three main important effects which can happen in the transformer. So what happens in the RMS current? We know that if the transformer, there will be a rating for the transformer, and if the transformer is sized for only for the KVA requirements of the load, then it cannot accommodate the harmonic currents in it, and which will cause increased RMS current in the system than the rated value. So when we have increased RMS current, obviously we will have the heat, more heat produced in the transformer. So when we are designing the transformers, also we have to have little higher KVA rating than the load requirements in the transformer. And then we have eddy current losses. These are mainly induced current in the transformer caused by the magnetic fluxes. So we know that eddy current is also proportional to the frequency, and in fact it is square of frequency. And when the frequency variations happen, when you have higher frequency components, the core losses and eddy current losses also will increase, and that will also have additional heating effects in the transformer. So these are the main impacts of harmonic currents in the transformer. And again here, the bottom line is that when we are designing the transformer, we have to have little overrating in the transformer so that it can accommodate the harmonic currents also. So this is the effect of harmonics in transformers. Now when we take the case of motors are can be significantly impacted by the harmonic voltage distortion, because when we have a distortion in the voltage, the flux in the motor also gets distorted. When the flux gets distorted, that flux is rotating at a frequency different from the synchronous frequency, because the flux has to rotate a synchronous frequency. But here, because the flux also gets distorted, it will rotate at a different frequency than the synchronous frequency. Thus, it will induce high frequency current in the motor also. So because of that, there will be much heating effect. So the effect of, again, you will have heating effect because of the increased frequency components in the current. And this effect of motors will be similar to the case of negative sequence currents in the system, where we have excessive heating happening. So all the main effects on the motors are the efficiency will be reduced because we have more heating in it. And you will have vibration because there will be torque pulsations in the motor. So because of that, we will have vibration in the motor, and we will have high-pitched noises also. Because of these higher frequency components, we will have high-pitched noises in the system. So these are the indicators of harmonic voltage distortion in the transformer. Next, we are going to see the impact on telecommunication wire. And so this is a typical diagram of a power system, which is interlinked with the telecommunication line. So we know that most of the places, the telecommunication lines are interlinked with the power system conductors, either through induction or through direct conduction. So that is there everywhere. Now, when harmonic currents are flowing in the utility distribution system, then this can interfere with the telecommunication line, or you can have an interference in the telecommunication line because if they are sharing a common path, there will be an interference. Also, the voltages induced in parallel conductors by a common harmonic current, they will fall within the bandwidth of normal voice communication also. So all these can affect the telecommunication line. Generally, the harmonics between a ninth harmonic, which is 550. Of course, it is taken in case of US, where it is fundamentally 60 hertz. So 550 within the range of 9th harmonic and 11th harmonic, which is 540 and 12th harmonic, basically. 540 and 1200 hertz are particularly disruptive for the telecommunication line. Also, the triplet harmonics also can affect the telecommunication line to a great extent. So the telecommunication lines also get impacted due to the harmonics in the power system. Now let us see the impact of energy and demand metering in the power system. So there are mainly two types of charges which are given in the billing when in the larger industrial customers, and they are energy charges and demand charges. Now what is this energy charge? It represents the cost of producing and supplying the total energy consumed over a billing period. And generally, this is measured in kilowatt hour. So that is called the energy charge. Apart from the energy charge, we have another one called demand charge, which will represent the utility cost. Mainly, this represents all the fixed costs in providing the peak power requirements. So that is called a demand charge. So there are two charges. One is the demand charge and then the energy charge. Energy charge is generally in kilowatt hour. Now the demand charge is usually determined by the highest 15 or 30 minute peak demand of use during the entire billing period. Now both these demand charge and energy charge are measured in kilowatt hour or watt hour. Now how this can get affected by the harmonics? That's what we are going to see. See, all these measurements are done with the meters which are installed in the particular place, right? Now when these meters are measuring, when harmonic currents are due to the nonlinear loads are entering this metering device, then there are magnetic disks in the conventional whatever meters. They will tend to have a negative error at the harmonic frequency. So this negative error can measure the power rating wrong with respect to the actual power rating when there is no harmonics present. So this is a major impact, and this error increases with the increased frequency. So as your harmonic component in the system increases, the error also increases. So all these are the effects of harmonics in the system. Now in the last, we have one more topic, which is called interharmonics. So far, we have seen the harmonics, which are all integer multiple of frequencies, which are present. But there is another terminal or another significant term, which we have is called the interharmonic frequency, which are non-integer multiple of fundamental frequency. So it is commonly known as interharmonic. So if you have non-integer multiple of fundamental frequency, we have interharmonic, that is called interharmonic. So all these days, all this time, we have seen only the integer multiple of harmonics. Now, what could be the real cause of interharmonics? One primary cause of interharmonics is again the electronic power converters only, which are capable of producing distortion, current distortion for a wide range of frequencies. So sometimes what happens when we have a special type of PWM techniques in the power converters, it can produce harmonics which are not only integer multiple, they can have non-integer multiple of harmonics also in the system. Now, another significant source of interharmonics is the induction furnaces and cycloconverters. So this figure is showing a typical induction furnace with a current source inverter, where there is an impact of harmonics, or which can produce interharmonics. Now, this impact of interharmonics are similar to those of normal integer multiples of harmonics. It can have overloading of the capacitance, pre-filter capacitance. It can create overheating. It can have power carrier interferences. All the problems we have seen due to harmonics can be caused by interharmonics also. Especially when the interharmonics frequency varies from time to time, because this is a highly time dependent factor, and it varies from time to time and depending upon how the load is acting. Suppose if you take the case of induction furnace, so this is a figure which shows an induction furnace. You can see that here in all earlier frequency spectrums, we have seen only the harmonics at particular integer multiples of frequency, fundamental frequency, right? But here we can see that there are a lot of frequency components present here, especially from 2 times, if not, especially from 120 hertz, you can see that a lot of frequencies are present. And not only the integer multiple, we have all the frequencies present. This is one typical frequency spectrum of an induction furnace. Now, the mitigation of interharmonics are much tougher than the mitigation of normal harmonics. In the next unit, we are going to cover how some methods of mitigating the harmonics. Generally, we have filters, active and passive filters. Now, when we have to mitigate this interharmonics, we will have to use wide bandwidth filters. So we'll be discussing that in the next unit. So we are coming to the end of sixth lecture of the module 3. Now we have one more lecture in this module, where I'll be taking you through some case studies, the real case studies, which have the harmonics and in the industrial and commercial applications where we have harmonics, and what are the effects of harmonics. So we'll be seeing that in the next